So for this episode, I got my buddy Jayson here, and we're just going to discuss just some real helpful tips that you should do as a beginner bass player, or more specifically, what not to do. So you were talking to me about something about some left-hand technique that you were saying, or you'll explain it better than I am.
Sure, yeah. It's something that I think everyone forgets. You know, they think bass is just straightforward or, you know, I mean, hammering the note out. But there's a lot you can do, and actually I think more with your left hand than with your right. You know, I mean, your right hand is driving it, right? But your left hand can really accentuate, you know, everything about the music. I mean, from the point where if you need an open driving note as compared to like a verse maybe where you want to suck back a little bit, you know. One of the examples I was thinking was just anything like if you're just pounding a note, you know, you're driving a note, simple A, you know, and then when something happens and you need to accentuate it, you can bounce it. You know,
right.
Bounce that note.
And maybe accent the one or accent the three.
As compared to just driving it, right? There's a time and a place for everything, you know? You just feel it out. You can drive it, pump it with your... And you're doing all this with your left hand, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're bouncing the note. Like, if you can see this, you're actually bouncing that note. See what I'm doing there? You know? And it's... Your right hand's doing nothing different than driving the note as if you were driving it. You're just doing it all with your left hand. It's important. It's huge in the song.
Do you find there's a difference between using open strings as opposed to fretted strings? Is there a time and a place where you maybe switch that up for tonal reasons?
Yeah, I guess more so. I would say for me, I tend to always play on the actual rather than playing open. I only play open when I have to. Sometimes it's just nice to make it easier on yourself, right? I have to say, you know, it's not no lie about it. You know, bass is a working man's instrument. You know. We're actually doing a lot more than the guitar. Like, I mean, he's busy doing a lot of, but I mean, we're driving that song and you have to keep that momentum up. And, you know, there's a lot of work to it. I mean, it's bigger strings. It's just more effort, I'm going to say.
I would say more labor
intensive.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, for sure it is. A guitar player can get away with a lot more mistakes than a bass player can. You make a bad one mistake and the whole room knows the guitar.
Yeah.
They just go right
through.
They
feel it. They feel when the bass is off, they feel it.
Yeah.
You know, it's true. Very true. Sometimes it's more important to not play a note, right?
Yeah. A quarter note rest will say much more than a 30-second jerk off fill almost every time. I mean, unless you're doing jazz or progressive metal or something like that where the song calls for it, but in general less is more.
I have an example for not playing a note.
Okay,
you know,
perfect.
Simply put, if you look at like a song, I was playing it last night, and when you're coming out of the pre-chorus on that Bryan Adams song, got my first real six string,
Summer 69.
Yeah, right.
Summer,
so, I mean,
69.
Yeah, it jumps up to the B, you know. Stop. You know, just that simple stop.
Right.
It you know, it just lights up. It's louder than a note. Because you just stop and you feel it in the music, there's nothing, and then when you come back in, it adds that strength.
Well, it's a tension and release, right?
Yes.
And again, like we said, a great example of when it's more effective to say nothing. I mean, you could have went right, and who cares, right? I tell you, who cares? The guy in the back who's got his arm crossed and goes, "I can do it better now." And guess what? He's not on stage playing, so he can fuck right off. That's not who you're playing for. You're always playing for the audience. I mean, you're playing for yourself, or like me, with myself. We can always edit.
Sometimes it's better to say nothing, John. I think we've both learned that.
There's a perfect example right there when it's better not to say anything. we were saying don't walk on the vocals.
Yeah.
Do not walk over the vocals. Like, that's not your time and place. Trust me, if you want a bass solo, you'll get one, and you'll regret that they gave you one.
That's the worst thing to walk over. You're true to the vocals. Like, you can... Solos, you know, if the guitar player is soloing, you can get away with a lot more. But when the singing starts, you really need to back off and let the vocals breathe, you know, so you're not, you know, you're not interrupting, really. I mean, if there's a specific line that the singer is trying to, you know, relay to the audience, you know, and you're soloing over top of it rather than just giving the singer what they need, which is generally the root.
Generally the root, yeah.
You know?
I mean, there are exceptions where you can either call and answer or even double the vocal line on a nice, like, simple pentatonic line or something like that. It's okay, particularly if the song's been going on for 11 minutes, like some drunken jam version of Hey Joe, you know, you get a little bored. Know the keys. Don't just know the roots. I mean, maybe your notes are C, G, and A, but is it C minor or is it C major? You got to know this. You have to know this. Yeah. It's really important. Now, if you just stick with the roots, you can get away with it, right? But you really need to know it. Do I go to from a C to a G, or do I go to a G sharp sometimes, right? Like, it really depends, and you need to know that. But I mean, honestly, major and minor is all you need, isn't it?
It really is.
Fuck them oats, man.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
Fuck them.
You're really good at transition notes. Like, I watch you play, and the way you transition from chord to chord, you obviously know what you know what key the song is being in, because if it's major, you have to use the major notes. If it's minor, you use the minor notes in the transition, right?
Right. And I mean, there are boxes that you can get away with. Like, you can use the blues pentatonic box
and get away with
everything, right? But then you're going to have the same riff every time you go to do a fill. Other than the octave or the key being different, it's the same riff. So you're playing the same three notes in five different positions, and that's fine, but you'll find that you're stagnating, particularly when you're trying to write or trying to break out of your box. That's where it's nice to know. But really, it's just hit and miss. One thing I will say that is contradictory to everything we're talking about, though, is if you do make a mistake, next time it comes around, do it again. Do it with conviction. You meant to do it. Make it work. You'd be surprised at how many times you read it that so even your top players will actually admit that.
I
do it all the time.
If I make a bum note, like even if it's not a bum note, but just I'm supposed to be driving a note and I play just one note and then I start driving it. When it circulates around, I'll do it again.
Yeah.
And then drive it again.
Exactly. Like it becomes part of the pattern. Yeah. Right, so I mean, this is expression, right? And with good expression comes confidence. And the only way you can do that is don't dip your toe in the water, man. Dive head first. And if you hit a rock, well, that's what beer's for.
Beer and hoots, yeah.
Beer and hoots, that's right. Yeah. All right, we're going to attempt here to show you an example of just jamming along and some of the ideas of simplicity. So
transition notes.
What's that?
Transition notes.
Oh, yeah. Okay, well, that's another lesson. About.
You'll see him do it.
Yeah. All right, give her.
Yeah.
Thank you. Nice.